was sent to Beijing to join us for today's event. Before the event begins, we would like to ask you to mute or turn your cell phone to vibration mode. Please follow our WeChat public account to get access to free Wi-Fi. Please allow me to introduce you to our center. Columbia Global Centers Beijing was established in March 2009 as one of the first in the network of Columbia Global Centers. As Columbia University's focal point in an open gate to China, the Beijing Center has a unique position linking China to the region, the hemisphere, and the rest of the global centers around the world, providing Columbia faculty and students with opportunities to expand their research and scholarship, but also as a conduit for knowledge exchange and skills development with local and regional academics, experts, and practitioners. Columbia Global Centers Beijing welcomes everyone to come and join us to experience Columbia in Beijing. This evening, we are honored to have Associate Provost and Director of Columbia University Press, Ms. Jennifer Crew, to talk about Columbia University Press and its history and relationship to the university. Ms. Crew will also talk about the press's long tradition of publishing that relates to China over six decades. In addition, she will discuss her idea to create a W.M. Theodore DeBerry Fund for books in ancient humanities. Please allow me to introduce Ms. Crew briefly. Ms. Crew is Associate Provost and Director of Columbia University Press, as I said, and also she is the first woman director of an Ivy League university press. Ms. Crew earned her Master of Fine Arts degree from Columbia School of the Arts and worked at the press during and immediately after graduate school. After working in the commercial college textbook publishing industry, she returned to the press 30 years ago, starting as an acquisitions editor. As editorial director, Crew hired and trained acquisitions editors who have nurtured close ties to and created excellent publication programs with academic departments and centers at Columbia. She is active in the wider world of publishing and academia. Having served on the board of the Association of American University Presses, the Executive Council of the Modern Language Association, and the Executive Council of the Professional and Scholarly Division of the Association of American Publishers. She is president-elect of the Association of American University Presses. Now, please join me and warmly welcome Ms. Crew to the stage.
Closer to the faculty and to the administration than at any other time in our history. So, my slides are going to give a whirlwind tour of the press, past, present, and future. First, I have to say that a great university needs a great university press. Scholarly publishing is a vital part of the research university ecosystem. Through its publishing programs, the press communicates the university's distinctive scholarly ideals and values to readers around the world. So we were founded in June of 1893 by Seth Lowe and Nicholas Murray Butler. And if you went to Columbia, you probably know those characters. Lowe Library is right in the middle of the campus, and Butler Library is too named after the two of them, and they are the ones who founded us. We are the fourth oldest American University Press. Most of us, American University Presses, were founded in the late 1890s and early 1900s. You can see that our friends in the UK had a 400-year head start on us. Our mission statement echoes that of Columbia University. We extend the reach and the reputation of the university by selling books with a Columbia imprint throughout the world. these are just some facts about the press. We're one of the most prestigious American university presses with one of the most rigorous approval processes. And if you want to, I can answer questions later if you're wondering how we approve a book, but we have a faculty publication committee that has to approve every book we offer a contract for. Every book we publish has at least two, if not more, peer reviews. It goes through sometimes two sets of peer reviews, and it has to pass an internal committee as well as a faculty committee. And we have one of the highest percentages of what we call in-house authors, local home authors, home faculty. For most university presses, about 6 to 10% of the home faculty will publish with the press at that campus. For us, it's more like 25%. And sometimes people ask me, you know, as a university press, are you there just to publish books by Columbia faculty? And the answer to that is no. We publish, we compete with Harvard University Press in Chicago and Yale and Princeton for the top authors on all the campuses. So what do university presses do? We do many things, but above all, we publish leading thinkers, writers, and scholars, including first books by younger scholars who show a lot of promise. We have very, as I said before, high standards for acceptance, and we disseminate the ideas of our scholars throughout the world. So this book that I have up here shows last year's Distinguished Book Award. This is an award I established 3 years ago with Provost John Coatsworth, with his help. It is given to a book published by the press, written by a faculty member, that are in the judgment of our publication committee brings the most distinction to the press and to the university. So this was by Joseph Stiglitz and Bruce Greenwald, Creating a Learning Society. And that has been translated into many languages. So Columbia University Press, this past fiscal year, our revenue was $11.5 million. We publish 200 new books a year. And I should say that of that $11.5 million, 65% of that is actually from sales of backlist books, not the current year's crop of books. So we have a lot of very steadily selling backlist titles. And these are some examples of some backlist titles. Man, the State and War is one of our strongest backlist sellers. It was the author's 1965 dissertation. He was a Columbia faculty member. And the book has sold about 2,000 copies a year every year since publication. The middle one there, the Zhuangzi, and excuse me for not pronouncing it correctly, most likely, is a classic work of Chinese philosophy translated by the late Burton Watson, also published in the 1960s. And that book also sells about 1,500 copies a year. And on the right there is The Sources of Chinese Tradition, edited by William Theodore DeBerry, who only recently died at the age of, I think, 98, and was very instrumental in establishing the Asian core course in humanities at Columbia, and the press worked alongside him to publish these translations from the Asian classics and these sources books. So that sources book sells very well for us. I think it's brought in about $2 million over its lifetime. So we publish, some people think, when they think of a university press, they think of scholarly books that only very serious researchers would read. We actually publish trade books, and these are two examples. Trade books are for the general reader, and they will be sold to stores. Amazon will sell them, but also in the States, Barnes & Noble and all the general interest bookstores. So we publish a certain portion of our list, our trade books, and the one there, The Madhouse Effect, has sold quite well. It's a book on global warming. We also publish scholarly monographs, and these are the books that we were really put on earth to publish. We were founded with the notion that we would publish books that commercial publishers would not find commercially viable. So these are just a few examples of recent monographs. These books are very important because they advance knowledge in a field, but they usually just sell to scholars and to libraries. They're not much carried by bookstores. The one on the right, I just learned, The Birth of Chinese Feminism, I don't know if you can read that, Essential Texts in Transnational Theory. And two of the editors of that BIP book, Lydia Lowe and Dorothy Koh, are at Columbia. And I just learned that this book has had a kind of a broad impact on a younger generation in China. It's been picked up by some artists who call themselves Thunderclap. I don't know if you've ever heard of them, but they broadcast the message of one of the main writers in this book, Hu Yinchen. So they are broadcasting her feminism under the cover of contemporary fashion. I don't really know about Thunderclap, but maybe some of you do. So we also publish reference and professional books. These are books for scholars. They're not stocked in bookstores because they're too specialized, but they have strong library sales. The one on the right, Classical Japanese, A Grammar, is by the chair of our East Asian Languages and Cultures Department, Haruo Shirane. And it's the kind of book that we love to publish because no commercial publisher would publish this. No one needs to know classical Japanese grammar unless they're studying pre-modern Japan. But this book, because nobody else did it, sells quite well on our backlist. So we also love to publish course adoption books. And these are not textbooks the way a commercial textbook publisher would publish them, like McGraw-Hill or something like that. They are aimed at upper-level undergraduate and graduate courses. And these are two, that's the other volume of Sources of Chinese Tradition. Most of our books in the translations from the Asian Classic series, which I mentioned earlier, founded by William Theodore DeBerry in the press in about 1960. They are considered by us to be course books because they are assigned to students, and students are the main purchasers of these books. They are sometimes bought by general readers, for example, the Analects of Confucius. Some people want to buy that and have that on their shelves. The one on the left, the Chuangzi, that is one of our best-selling, it's one of the oldest books, the earliest books in the series, and it's one of our best-sellers. We continue to add books to this series every year. The one on the right, The Songs of Chu, a very ancient text, was just published this year. We sell translation rights to our books, and this is just a snapshot of the rights deals that we conducted in last fiscal year in fiscal 2017. And as you'll see, China tops the list there they're our biggest customers for translation rights. Simplified rights lead the list, then Korea and Japan, and then complex characters in Chinese. The rest are much smaller. This activity, by the way, doesn't bring us a lot of money, but it is the way we fulfill our mission to get our books around the world, and the authors love it when their books are translated. This is just a little snapshot of a few recent books that we've sold in Chinese language rights to. So for a recent history, in 2014, the provost commissioned a review of the press. And this was because our former director had retired and he wanted to take a look and see both internal faculty thought of the press, and also external, a couple of other university press directors were the external reviewers. And both of the reports recommended that the press become a unit of the university instead of an affiliate. For all our years since from our founding, 1893 on up, we've been a separately incorporated not-for-profit company. And we were incorporated that way by Seth Lowe and Nicholas Murray Butler because, as I read in the minutes of the trustees meeting way back when we were founded, they did not want the university to be involved in a printing operation. And this is just a kind of serendipitous thing. Some university presses, like Chicago, was founded as a department of the university. Others were units. It was rare to be an affiliate the way we were, but they thought it would be involve a printing press. Actually, sometimes it did involve printing presses, and that's the origin of the word press, by the way. People, publishers had actual printing presses. But because of this review that we had, and because of faculty feeling that was expressed to the provost, we became a unit of the university in January 2016. And this has been a hugely advantageous move for us, allowing us to become closer to the university's intellectual agenda and also to benefit from its strong administrative and academic leadership. And just from a personal point of view, it was much easier for me because I didn't have to deal with worrying about health insurance for all of our employees, for example, or legal matters that now are taken care of by the university. So it's been really, really a savings in many ways for us as well. So after, well, it was actually before we became a unit, but after I became director of the press, we prepared a strategic plan, and the main goals of that plan, it went from 2014 to 2017, we're now starting a new one. The main goals came out of the reviews of the press, and we really focused more on faculty engagement with the press, raising the profile of the press both on campus and off, and improving and expanding our publication programs. We also had a goal of working with the Office of Alumni and Development to begin a fundraising program. And the reason I wanted to start a fundraising program what is illustrated by this slide. So a major competitive disadvantage for the press is our very small endowment. And this is something I really am determined to rectify. Our two main competitors, or our main competitors, Harvard, Princeton, Yale, and Chicago, all have endowments that were established decades, if not I think a century ago in the case of Princeton and Harvard. These presses don't actively fundraise at all, they don't need to. Then there's a group of state university presses that actually started fundraising 20 or 30 years ago and they've had some success. And they all have active fundraising programs that I'm learning from. And Columbia's small endowments, we have three small endowments for specific areas of publication. One is for translations of literature, nobody even remembers decades and decades ago gave us some money for translations of literature, and I'm eternally grateful to that person. Then we have a small endowment for books in US East Asia relations given to us by one of our authors on her deathbed. She wanted to do some good and give money for this field, and we were thrilled. And then another one, the smallest endowment, is for Chinese Buddhist studies, and it happens that we publish in that field, and it's enough money to allow us to publish one book a year, and it's great to have because scholarly books in Chinese Buddhist studies really don't sell that many copies, so it's good to have money to offset that. So in my quest for raising funds, I really want to participate in the Columbia Commitment Campaign, which is just being launched now. And as it happens, there's a happy coincidence that the press has active and actually very prestigious publishing programs in five of the seven themes of this campaign. One of the five that we're involved in are global solutions, climate response, future of neuroscience, just societies, and arts and ideas. So we're trying to work with the Office of Alumni and Development to tell people about our books in those areas. I've also established an advisory council, which is helping us with fundraising and also helping us with strategic planning. And we also plan to, we developed something called the Publisher Circle, which is a sort of like a friends group. We started last year and we actually raised $79,000 just from authors, and some, it was really touching. Some humanities authors gave us $1,000. It was really very nice because they don't make a lot of money. But a lot of them were grateful that we got a lot of people saying, oh, you published my first book, you got me tenure, I'm giving back now. So that was very nice. And we also plan to approach foundations and institutions. And we're gonna start a donor affinity group for French translations. We do a lot in French. I also wanna secure funding for a DeBerry Award. I don't know if any of you ever took a course with him, but he was quite an amazing person. He was a dean of the college. He was provost, actually, and a dean, and he was one of a group of three extremely imaginative people who learned Japanese during the Navy and during World War II. It was William DeBerry, Donald Keen in Japan, and Burton Watson. And the reason I'm in China right now is I was asked to speak about Burton Watson in Xi'an. They're developing a Burton Watson Center for Translation. Burton Watson, they all came to Columbia after the war, and Burton got his PhD at Columbia. I think Ted already had his. And Burton translated, I think we have 41 books on our backlist by him, and they're all translations of Chinese and Japanese works of literature, philosophy, and history. He translated, he did his PhD degree on Sima Qian and translated the records of the Grand Historian and many, many other books. And then from Japan, he translated pre-modern and also modern works. So Ted hired Burton and Donald Keen to start translating works for the sources of Chinese and sources of Japanese tradition. So these sources books that I keep mentioning, they were developed for the core course in Asian Humanities at Columbia. And at that time, right after the war, there was very little available in English. The core texts of Asian civilizations couldn't be taught unless we had them translated into English. So that's what these books did. And the first ones in the late 1950s, early 60s, were the sources of Chinese tradition, the sources of Japanese tradition, and the sources of Indian tradition. After I came to the press, and I've been there now 31 years, I got the sources of Korean tradition going. And then much later, we did the sources of Vietnamese tradition, and then the sources of Tibetan tradition, and I have a Mongolian volume in the works now, too. So I just wanted to show you the cover of Ted DeBerry's last book. And I think it's really, I really feel it would be a great thing to carry on his legacy through the continuation of this publishing program he started and worked with the press on for over six decades. And then last, I want to show you this slide because it's going to be our 125th anniversary next year, so we're gearing up, and if anybody's around in March, we're going to have an event in Loeb Library to celebrate that. These are the members of my advisory council. You see that a couple of them are in the global centers. And we actually wanted to do some work with the global centers to try and do some publishing, maybe online, open access publishing of work that might come out of the global centers. So that's why I have Vishaka Desai and Paul LeClerc helping me. And
And then this is our publication committee, and these people gather around the table once a month, and they look at the proposals that the editors have for books they'd like to publish. They look at a little précis of the book, table of contents, maybe 20 pages of it, the peer reviews, and they read all that material, and they have a big debate about whether, you know, the merits of the book, or what are the problems with the book that need to be fixed, or any number of things. And so we do not offer a contract for a book unless this group has approved it. And this is our current group. It does change. They serve 3-year terms, and they're actually renewable. So you could, if you love being on the committee, and some people do, you could stay 6 years, but then they rotate off. And then finally, I have, after the review and before we became a unit, I developed an advisory board. These are faculty members who just give us advice. We had the first couple of years we met 3 times a year, and now we just sort of see them as problems arise or questions arise. So that's the end of my formal comments, but I would be happy to take questions.
I'm a faculty member from the China Frontiers University. I wonder if there is any way to contact the advisory or academic committee to see if the topic I'm working on is well suited for publication. Is there any way to do that?
Well, you wouldn't contact them. You would contact the relevant editor at the press, because they only see it at the very end. For final approval. We have 9 editors, and they all handle different fields. Usually the editors are handling 2, if not 3 fields. So depending on your topic, I could tell you who to contact. And so that editor could say whether it fits or not. And if the editor thinks a book is right, then they'll look at a proposal. If there's a manuscript there, they might, they'll talk about it with colleagues at the press. If we all decide to go ahead and have it reviewed, then it gets peer reviewed, then we discuss it again, and then finally it goes to that group. Any other questions? Yes.
You mentioned a lot, like there, you know, Chinese book translated to English, right? I have 2 questions. You know, what do you see about to translate some Columbia, you know, press books to Chinese? You know, what has been going on, and how to do that? For example, if I'm interested in one book from a business school, of Columbia Business School, what should I do to try to translate to Chinese? Yeah. And having to publish in China, for example.
Right. Yeah. So, are you a publisher?
I'm not, but I publish a few books. By
okay.
Myself, yeah.
So we have a rights department and a rights director, and the rights director goes to the Beijing Book Fair. She also goes to Frankfurt Book Fair in London, and she pitches our titles to publishers around the world.
Okay.
So she'd be the first person to contact. But it's mainly, we usually have publisher-to-publisher arrangements. So I never recommend that a person translate a book and then try to find a publisher for it, because you never know if it's already been, the rights have already been sold or something like that. But it's if there's an important book that you think should be translated into Chinese, you could contact us and recommend Chinese publishers, because we have relations with a number of them. Or you can contact the Chinese publisher and say, I think maybe you should translate this book, and they can get in touch with us.
Okay.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah,
okay.
Thank you.
Yes?
I'm just wondering, because all the publishing publishers around the world are facing growing pressures from other forms of media. So I'm wondering, there are any measures from Columbia Press to diversify or try to cooperate or form a different or a new types of the publisher or books and collaborated with other forms of new media. Maybe you have something inspiring to us.
I don't know about that. I do know that we love short books. we publish a lot of very long books, but we're certainly aware of this problem of people's attention spans, and they don't want to read a really long book. So we try to especially if it's a trade book, a general interest book, we try to get the author to do it in as short a space as possible because it means that we'll sell more copies. But in terms of other multimedia, no, we do. I mean, the reviewing of books has been shifting to online reviews and blogs and cover. There are fewer traditional print media book reviews now, and so we do pitch to all sorts of online sites and blogs and things to try to get our books noticed. And we try to make sure that our authors, particularly for the general interest books, will be are kind of media savvy and will try to promote the books themselves, that kind of thing. But it is a problem that we certainly are facing.
Well, yeah. I'd just like to add something. You do know that Springer, the German media, they recently established cooperation between with the Chinese technology giant Tencent. Mm-hmm. So I'm just wondering that maybe it shows a new way that's
it's possible. I know that for some publishers, particularly textbook publishers, you know, they're all these textbooks are going more less print and more electronic for that reason. But for our books, for the scholarly books, particularly the humanities, we find that people just want the book. They want the print book. And 10 years ago or so, we were all panicked. We thought, okay, the book's gone. It's all going to be e-books or electronic everything. And then last year, I think it was, or the year before, we started to see, I mean, e-book sales were going up like crazy, and then they just plateaued, and now they're a little bit down. I think the hype about ebooks was very big and had us all thinking everything would change, and now we find that it's going back. And actually, our ebook sales, it's really only 12% of our total revenue. Half of that is consumer ebooks, Kindle and iPad and that kind of thing, and half of it is library platforms.
Thank you very much for the talk. I work in the U.S. as a faculty member in California. So I have two questions. One is that translation usually shows the flow of knowledge from one country to another. So the chart you just showed us shows that very clearly, right?
Yeah.
So the Chinese are buying a lot of translation rights of American books, because that's where the knowledge flows, and most of the Chinese titles that have been translated into English are the classics, right? So I wonder, for Columbia University Press and for American academic press in general, are there increasing number of more contemporary and recent titles that are in Chinese that are being translated into English? Given the sort of the perhaps we can say the rising position of Chinese knowledge, right, and the so forth. The second question is that my field is in political science, But my work is in a more humanity side of political science. But you know, in social sciences, there is this divide between the more quantitative scientific outlook of some fields and the more humanity and softer topics. I wonder, from a publisher's point of view, right, when you think about the audience's interest and so forth, how should I frame my question? Is the press's preferences for the harder, more scientific with charts and data and all that, right? And the more humanity based and softer topics, what is your preference? Does that make sense? From the publisher's point of view, not from the academic sort of author point of view.
Okay. I think it depends on each university press develops a specialization in certain areas. For example, you know, as I've just been talking about, Columbia happens to be probably the best in Asian studies just because it happened that there were people way back in the post-war period who decided it was important for Americans to learn about Asia. So that's just a coincidence. We also happen to have a very strong social work list, and that's because one of our editors at one time got friendly with somebody in the social work school, and there was no other university press doing social work. So it's a kind of serendipitous thing, but all of us develop certain specializations. So there may be some publishers, Cambridge for one, that's very interested in the sort of what we would call the hard side political science, and others that would do, like Columbia, we don't really do that much of that, but we do more political theory, we do continental philosophy, we do more sort of, you know, as the hard side people would say, sort of squishy, more in the humanities end. So it really just depends on an editor develops a list, and the list has a certain character, so you have to kind of look at, if you're looking for a publisher, you look at the recent books on their list and whether yours would fit into that sort of conversation. Now that was the second question. The first question about translation, I would say that of that chart that I showed, I have to say the vast majority of those books that we sell to China are in our, we have an imprint with the business school called Columbia Business School Publishing. And these are, a lot of them are on value investing and management and that kind of thing. And those are the ones that sell, well, at least they're the ones that have the biggest advances. But we sell a lot of other books too to China. We happen to publish a lot of Chinese fiction in translation, modern Chinese literature. We do also publish some nonfiction, some general history. There was a history of China we did. There's an economic history. There are various things that we do that are translations of more contemporary Chinese. But I would say that the scholarly books, well, first of all, it's expensive to translate. So for a narrow scholarly monograph, you already have more costs than you have revenue. So to add translation costs on top of that is impossible. So we don't do that kind of book, but a very general book we might do. And weirdly, I just, and this goes along with the question about short books, we just translated from the German. There are two different German sinologists. One is a specialist in traditional Chinese medicine. He has a very short book in German on traditional Chinese medicine. We translated that and published it, and I think it's going to sell a lot of copies because people are really interested in that topic. And I have another one by a different German scholar called China, I can't remember the exact title, but it's on Chinese writing, it's on calligraphy, characters, and how they developed. So we will translate something if we can afford the translation costs. It means we think we can sell a higher level of books. So that's okay. Yes.
thanks for your speech. I come from the company who, which organized the BIBF you just mentioned.
Yes.
And I have a similar question like her, that when you choose the Chinese titles to translate, will you focus more on modern ones or the classical ones? What is the percentage of each group?
Well, because we have a history of doing these translations from the Asian classics, we're always looking to add to that that list. So that's a very big, robust list. And we don't have to, you know, we're not gonna have to pay rights costs for, these are public domain works. So, and usually there are scholars who are translating them because it's pre-modern and they, you know, there are a lot of notes and there are things that they have to add to make it understandable. So those books, it's in a different kind of category from translating a contemporary book where you have to pay for the rights and then pay for someone to translate it. So as I said before, we do those, but we are, we have to be, well, nobody can be sure how many copies it'll sell, but we have to feel as though it will sell enough copies to earn back the cost of translation. So certainly for us, it's a bigger percentage of the classics, but on the other hand, we have this other series, the Weatherhead Books on Asia, that includes fiction, and we get some subvention to offset the cost of those. Not that much, but some.
And can I have a second one?
Sure.
For my personal interest.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm interested in the fund that you introduced to us. I mean, for this part, will you consider in the future about the foundation idea? I'm not sure, because the fund is sometimes related to foundation. I don't know. For this kind of innovation, will you develop more into some different forms in your idea or in your strategy?
Not sure I understand. I mean, for the William Theodore DeBerry Fund?
Yeah.
Well, for that, I'm thinking of several ways of doing it, but one might be, there might be a donor who had courses with him or was very interested in this field or knew his contribution, he might want to contribute in his name. That's one way I might go about it. Another way is that in the early days, we, royalties from the very early books, the first editions of the sources books, for example, went into a fund at the university. And so now they're going to let us keep some of that to have a fund in his name. So that's the beginning of it. But I'm thinking, is that what you mean? Is that what you asked or not?
I will keep following that. So do you have a website?
Does the press have a website?
The fund.
Oh, no, no, fund, no, it's just a gleam in my eye right now. Yeah, I'm just trying to think it through right now.
I hope you can share more about this part in the near future, because as a kind of researcher, I'm interested in this,
okay.
In this kind of innovation.
Okay, so we can talk afterwards.
Yeah.
Thanks very much for your sharing. Mm-hmm. And I'm an editor from the Peking University Press. And I learned from the introduction that you have a lot of experience in editor training. And I wondered, I know it's a long way to be a good acquisition editor. Do you have any suggestions? What's the basic skills for a good acquisition editor? And thank you very much.
Okay, well, it's, I guess, it depends on the different type of publisher, because the acquisitions, for example, if you're, at least in the US, if you're an editor for a trade like Penguin Random House, or, you know, for Arstrostru, or one of the general interest top flight publishers, those editors
get books mainly through agents. So they have to cultivate good relationships with literary agents who have authors that they can say, oh, I think this author would be right for you, and that kind of thing. But for us, although we do work with agents, our editors are assigned several fields. For example, I've got an editor who does philosophy and religion, somebody else who does social work and political science, somebody else who does this various sciences, somebody else who does the business school list. So those people, and for university presses in the U.S., what they do is they have to learn how to have a crash course in that field, usually without having a PhD in it. And that means reading the key journals, going to the conferences, meeting people. And so it's just a cultivating people and talking to people and figuring out how they can develop their list so that it's distinguished and distinguishes itself from the other lists around. So usually, publishing is kind of an old-fashioned thing. So they usually, a lot of them were editorial assistants, and they learned from the editors they were working for, and sometimes then they moved up, or they moved to another house to when an opening came. But there isn't really a kind of how-to thing. It's really a mentor situation. But there is this organization that I'm going to become president of, the Association of American University Presses, has groups of acquisitions editors and webinars and things like that to help as well. And then there are conferences that we go to, the AAUP conference or the professional scholarly publishing. They have sort of workshops and things.
I actually have two questions.
Okay.
The first one is, have you started any strategic cooperation with Chinese publishers? If not, what kind of publishers you are looking for to work with in the next 5 years? And the second one is, as you are the president of the American University Association of University Presses, and I do know you accept international participants, to be a member of the American Association of University Presses.
In fact, we just dropped the name American from it. It's now the Association of University Presses. For that reason, we want more international members.
Okay, that's a great idea. And what kind of basic requirements you have for or any kind of suggestions you have for Chinese publishers if we want to become an international member of that association? Thank you.
Okay.
I'm from FLTRP, the publisher.
Okay. So there is, I can speak to you after, there is a, on the website of the association, well, I think the website is in the process of being changed over to the new name, but it's probably still the AAUPnet.org website. There are instructions, and I can, or you could just email me, and I can give you the link. There are different memberships. There's different levels of membership, and the international publishers who join are at, I think, associate member level. But you can read what needs to be done. It's an approval process. Basically, it needs to be a peer-reviewed press. Not for profit, and not for profit, the definition of that changes country to country. For example, I don't think in England they really have not for profit organizations in the same way, yet, you know, Manchester University Press, Liverpool, etc., are members. So that I'm not quite sure how that's defined, but anyway, it's must be peer reviewed. You must have a board that looks over the. It doesn't have to be as stringent as our board, once a month meeting. Some of them are a little looser than that, but there are different rules that are all listed there, and we love to have international members. And now at the Frankfurt Book Fair, there is a regular International University Press meeting on the Saturday at the end of the fair. And in terms of, we don't have a sort of, at Columbia, we do have relationships with a number of Chinese university presses, but we don't have a kind of strategic plan for that. I know that Princeton University Press does. They have an office here now. They've opened an office. So there's some, depends on, you know, how wealthy the press is, how much money they can spend on. We don't happen to have enough money to have a an actual office here, but I think everybody's interested in cooperating. Yes.
It's my honor to see you today. I have a question. So which film the Columbia Press focuses on?
Which fields?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, it'll be hard for me to, I'll probably skip some. But so we publish in philosophy, and mostly it is what we call continental philosophy, Asian philosophies for sure, not so much the traditional analytic philosophy.
Social sciences?
Social science, yeah. We have broadly humanities, social sciences, and science. Science is fairly small. It's life science and climate science and some paleontology. In the social sciences, we have sociology, political science, political theory. Maybe that's it. What, do you have a specific question?
I mean, the most focus is on is a social sciences.
No, I'd say our biggest area is humanities, and second is social sciences.
Oh,
okay, I see. Thank you very much.
Hello. I want to ask you about the as a reader. So, what do you think is most important when you read a book? Maybe when I read a book, I want to know a story, or when I want to have a sense, have a feeling. What do you think is most important for a book? For a good book, just as a reader.
So I would say for the kinds of books that we publish, and I think you're talking about general readers, not so much scholars, because we publish a lot of scholar books where the scholars just want to get the information they want, and it's not so important that they read from beginning to end. They're dipping in and finding information. So that's one kind of book we do. But for the books that I said before were trade books, general interest books, we like to make sure it has a clear argument, that there's a clear message that you can sort of describe that book, to a friend in a sentence or two, and you can really get the essence of the book. If you can't do that, it's probably not a general interest book. So we like books that, the books that we publish on our trade list that are for general readers, we like to really be able to say, for example, The Madhouse Effect, okay, let me remember this, the subtitle really says, How Climate Change Denial is Threatening Our Planet, Destroying Our Politics, and Driving Us Crazy. So this is really, explaining why it's crazy to deny the fact that human beings are changing our climate. And that book happens to have cartoons, but the cartoon on the front is done by a professional cartoonist, and there are cartoons throughout, and he illustrates this kind of thing very well. So we'd like it to have a clear argument, we'd like it to be written in an accessible way, and as a university press, I can tell you there are many faculty who write lots of good scholarly books, and they think they can write a trade book, but they actually cannot do it. That you ask them what the book's about, and they cannot explain it in one sentence. So it's a skill to be able to write well and to have the courage to be very clear about your ideas and to simplify them so that someone else can decomplicate, is really the better word than simplify, so that it can be understood. And I always try to say, you know, if you're, your cousin who loves to read and is very intelligent but nevertheless does not have a PhD, if that person can understand and read what you're writing, then you're on the right track.
How do you decide when you confront difficulties? For example, some of book that totally contradiction. Sometimes they have a very special, the opposite the opinion. And how do you decide? Just like for you mentioned, just like climate change. Some of them they describe that a big problem, but some of them it's nothing. How do you do?
You mean sometimes when we send a book, the editor is quite interested in considering a book and sends it to two peer reviewers. And sometimes we get one peer reviewer saying, this is the greatest thing I've ever read on this topic, it's excellent, blah, blah, blah. And then the other person says, this is terrible, you should not publish it. Is that what you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we do have that happen, and it happens, I'd say, you know, at least several times a year. Well, probably it happens once every 2 months or something. So then the editor will often send it out to a third reader. And the editor will also try to figure out what it is about the book that is causing such disagreement. And sometimes it happens to be a controversial topic or a controversial method or approach, and the one reader just loved it and the other one didn't. Sometimes there's professional jealousy. The one who's negative feels as though his or her books were not cited, or, you know, feels there's some competition. Sometimes you can really tell that there's they're not being objective. And then sometimes if we can't figure it out, we take it to the faculty publication committee or the relevant person on that committee and say, can you help me figure this out? And that person will usually say, oh, we'll send it to so-and-so and see what that person says. So the editor is really the book's advocate and trying to get it through the committees, but if there's something seriously wrong, they don't want to pursue it, so they seek advice. We seek advice from faculty to figure out what the issue is. Is that your question, or was it something else? That's okay. All right. Well, thank you very much. I'd be happy to answer any other questions.